Thank you, Mr. Chairman, distinguished guests on the podium, and the distinguished audience here. I'm very glad to be here today to be able to participate in SANEM's conference. Although it is their second conference, it's the first time I'm participating, and I'm extremely grateful to Siddiqur Rahman for inviting me here. The topic as my lecture today, I'm not going to give any PowerPoint presentation. I don't have a written paper either, unfortunately. She'll be speaking essentially from, partly from memory, and since memory is fading with age, partly also based on my notes here. The topic, as Salim has said, is democracy and development. Now, anytime, anywhere, democratic freedoms are curtailed, particularly in a developing country, you come across two opposite kinds of reactions. The first normal reaction, of course, is a sense of resentment on the part of those who value democracy. The opposite reaction, which is not opposite in the sense that it doesn't value democratic freedoms, but the opposite reaction tends to say that, look, we understand that your freedoms have been curtailed, but look at the bright side, because sometimes curtailment of democratic freedom may actually help promote economic development. Is that a valid proposition? This is the question I'm going to discuss today. Now, you see, the debate on whether democracy is good for development or not has been an age-old debate. It has a long history. But the way the debate has been framed, the question that has been asked often is in the form of, does democracy promote development? I think we need to change the question in a very important way. And the question we should ask is not whether democracy helps development, but the question we should ask is, does democracy hinder development? It may be a subtle change, but the change is important. And the reason I'm asking for this change is the following. You see, you must, if you think of a broader definition of development, development is not just material well-being. Development also includes expansion of freedoms of all kinds, including expansion of democratic freedoms, your civil and political freedoms. In that sense, democratic freedom is a constituent of development itself. So in that sense, democracy has two roles in the context of development. One is the constitutive role, and the other is the instrumental role. The constitutive role is always positive. If you have democratic freedoms, it helps in one dimension of development, which is the freedom dimension of development. Then the question arises, what is the instrumental role? If in the instrumental role we find, imagine that we come to the conclusion that democracy neither helps nor hinders development, it is neutral. If that were the conclusion, then our overall conclusion would be democracy wins. Because on the one hand, it promotes the freedom dimension of development, which is the constitutive value of democracy. On the other hand, it doesn't do anything to harm the other economic dimensions of development. So by Pareto criteria, democracy is the superior arrangement. So the only thing we need to ask is, does democracy hinder development? If it does hinder development, there is a conflict here between the constitutive role and the instrumental role. If there is such a conflict, then we may have to make a compromise. But if there is no such conflict, no compromise, democracy wins. So that's the reason I want to ask the question, does democracy hinder development? The other side of the coin is, does lack of democratic freedom promote development? In an extreme form, does autocracy promote development? If you ask the question in this form, then you find that actually there are a number of arguments that have been made in the literature which seem to claim that yes, autocracy can promote development better than democracy. Before I enter into those arguments, let's make one thing clear, first of all, that before going into the relative question of whether autocracy or democracy is better, in an absolute sense, we have to accept that autocracy can promote development. in an absolute sense. There are many examples in the world where developments have occurred under autocratic regimes. You only have to look at some of the East Asian countries. There are also some good sound theoretical reasons why autocracy can promote development. Although autocrats may not be particularly interested in the well-being of the people, they can still promote development. And one such argument was made by the famous political economist Mankar Olson in an article called Dictatorship, Democracy, and Development, published in 1993. He made an interesting distinction between roving bandits and stationary bandits, equating autocrats with stationary bandits. The argument simply is this: when there is anarchy, roving bandits are plundering the people. They have a very short-term interest. They plunder as much as they can and go away. But if you have a stationary bandit, then you do not want to plunder too much, because you want to stay there, so you want to improve the productive potential in the future so that you can plunder more in the future. So in order to support his own desire to plunder, the autocrat, the stationary bandit, may want to promote development so the productive potential of the economy grows, and therefore his opportunity to plunder also grows. So for his own self-interest, a stationary bandit would promote economic development and growth. And we have known quite a few stationary bandits in our own lifetime, in our own lands, and you know who they are. And they did promote development to some extent. So in an absolute sense, autocracy can promote development. And in that sense, one can argue that democracy is not necessary for development. But that's not the real issue. The issue is not whether it's necessary. The issue is the relative one. Is autocracy superior to democracy? In this superiority context, a number of arguments have been proposed by some who argue that democracy may be a good thing in its own sake, but autocracy is actually better for development. Three arguments I shall mention. There are a number of arguments. I shall focus on three. The first argument says is based on accumulation, savings, investment, and growth. The first argument says that in a democratic society, there will be too much pressure for immediate consumption because the poor people want to have a better life immediately. And if you spend too much on consumption, very little will be left to save, to accumulate and invest, and therefore growth will be slow. Whereas in an autocracy, the autocrat can be ruthless. It doesn't matter what the poor people want. They can be ruthless in constraining consumption so that more savings can be generated, more capital can be accumulated, and growth will be faster. That's the accumulation route through which autocrats are supposed to promote growth better. A second route is called insulation from pressure group politics. The argument is, in democracy, there are too many interest groups vying with each other, trying to influence the democratic process, the politicians, the legislature, and the bureaucrats. And because of the interest group pressures, the government often cannot adopt policies that are efficient and productive for the economy, because they have to pander to special interest groups. Whereas in autocracy, the autocrat can insulate himself from this pressure because he doesn't have to listen to anybody. So because he can insulate himself, he can adopt policies that are efficient and productive for the economy. That's the second argument for the superiority of autocracy. The third argument is a slightly subtle one. It says that its argument actually goes back to the famous French sociologist come jurist of the 19th century, Alexis de Tocqueville, who in his well-known paper, celebrated book on democracy in America, made the argument in a rudimentary form. Then it was subsequently formalized by economists Alan Mesler and Richards. The argument is that in a democracy, there will be pressure for redistribution towards the poor, and the redistribution will happen only by raising taxes. And the greater the pressure of redistribution towards the poor, the higher will be the taxes. But taxes have distortionary effects on the economy, and therefore those higher taxes will deter the growth of the economy. But in a democracy. In an autocracy, there is no such pressure, so taxes can be kept low. Therefore, the disincentive effect on the economy can be kept low. This is called the Tocqueville effect on taxes, and therefore the distortionary effects. Now, these theoretical arguments in favor of autocracy, however, each of them can be contested. The first two arguments, which says that the autocrat can actually promote development by promoting faster accumulation and by insulating themselves against special groups, only suggests that autocrats can do those things. But can doesn't mean will. They can, but will they do so? What is in it for them? Why would they want to? What is the motivation of the autocrats? If you ask the motivation question, then it is not at all obvious that the autocrat will do what is good for the economy. The motivation of the autocrat, think of this allegory of the stationary bandit. What does a stationary bandit wants to do? He wants to maximize his own earnings from the economy over a period of time. He is a profit maximizer, he's a surplus maximizer, not profit maximizer. He's a surplus maximizer. He would like to give something to the people so that their productive capacity grows, but his essential interest is his surplus maximization. And the strategies and policies that maximizes his surplus doesn't necessarily maximize the national income of the country. Even if the national income falls, if his share of that income goes up, he can still increase his surplus. So surplus maximization does not require national income maximization or productive potential maximization. And that is an argument that Mankar also had made against autocracy, that they may have the capacity to accumulate faster and grow faster. But just because they have the capacity, they are not going to use it because their main interest is in surplus extraction. And what maximizes their surplus will not necessarily maximize the national income of the country. Another argument that has been made against this idea is by a political economist called James Robinson in a very interesting paper titled Theories of Bad Policies, published in 1998. His argument was that look at the autocrat again. He wants to improve the productive potential, of course, of the country, because that will give him a base from which he can plunder more. But he has to use some machinery to extract those surplus. Now, the problem is that the institutions that you will create to promote the productive potential, property rights, a system of institutions whereby people's contracts will be respected, those economic freedoms and guarantee of rights, which are essential for improving the productive potential economy. These very institutions may actually hamper his own capacity to extract the surplus. So the institutions which will promote development are not necessarily the institutions that you want, because the same institution will tie his hands. Therefore, he will not choose the growth promoting institutions. He will promote bad policies for the country, because that's what he needs in order to extract his own surplus. The final argument, the Tocqueville argument, that the pressure for taxes will be high pressure for high taxes will be higher in a democracy rather than autocracy, actually been contested by an economist called Wojin Lee, who wrote a paper in 2003 in Journal of Development Economics. He said, well, there is this pressure from the poor people in democracy to redistribute in their favor, and that might lead to higher taxes in democracy. But that doesn't mean there is no other pressure in autocracy. In autocracy, there will be a pressure for redistribution in favor of the autocrat and the elite group who works with him. And because of this pressure for redistribution bias in favor of the elites, they might too want to raise the taxes so that more surplus can be created for redistribution. Of course, the elite is aware that if you raise taxes too high, then the disincentive effects may reduce national income. But so what? If you reduce the national income, if the share of the redistribution goes up, the percentage goes up, the higher percentage of the reduced income can still be high for them. This is what Lee calls the Olson effect. So if you posit the Tocqueville effect on the one hand and the Olson effect on the other, the net effect is not necessarily favorable in terms of autocracy. So on theoretical grounds, there is no reason to believe that autocracy is superior to democracy in promoting development. Conversely, there is no reason to believe that democracy will hinder development compared to lack of democracy. So what is the evidence? These are theoretical arguments. What's the evidence regarding the relative superiority of the two systems? Now, until about the middle of the 2000s, around 2005, 2006, until that time, the general consensus amongst most people who had studied this phenomenon empirically, the general consensus was the evidence is inconclusive. Many studies showed that development is that democracy promotes development better than autocracy. Many other studies showed the opposite, that autocracy promotes development better than democracy. And many other studies showed that we don't know. It's just there is no real difference. So the evidence was taken to be inconclusive. But there has been further research in the last decade. And this recent research actually overturns that consensus and conclusively demonstrates that on balance, democracy performs better than autocracy in promoting development. It doesn't mean that every democracy will be necessarily superior to every autocracy. It's a statistical generalization, which means on the average, democracies do perform better than autocracies in promoting growth. I'm talking about economic growth for the time being. Economic growth, on balance, democracy does superior, overturning the consensus that existed in the mid-2000s. Second, already in the mid-2000s, there was already a consensus that whatever happens to growth, there was clear evidence that democracy promotes human development better than autocracy. If you leave aside growth, but look at other things like education, infant mortality, life expectancy, and other dimensions of human development, there was already a consensus at the time that democracy is better for that. And that consensus has been strengthened by recent research, which has confirmed that yes, democracy is superior when it comes to promoting human development. The third empirical finding is that, and that was again accepted in the mid-2000s, even at the time when people were saying that effect on growth evidence is inconclusive, even at that time, there was a general agreement from empirical research that democratic countries had more stable growth and autocratic countries has more volatile growth. And one of the pioneering researchers in this area is our own very own Bangladeshi young professor at Yale, Mushfiq Mubarak, who one of his earliest researchers demonstrated that autocracies may have higher growth on the average, but that growth is volatile, goes up and down. Whereas democracies, even if the average is low, goes on a more stable path. And volatility of growth may actually create, in the long term, slow growth by creating uncertainty. And in that respect, democracy is superior. The final finding I want to emphasize is that when people look at effect of democracy on whether it is growth or human development, whatever, you can look at it two perspectives. What is the effect of democracy today on growth 5 years from now? But you also can look at what is the effect of history of democracy. How many years have you been democracy? Have you been democratic for 5 years? Have you been democratic for 20 years, 50 years? And they show that the longer you have a democratic experience, the better the growth performance and human development performance at any given level of present level of democracy. So history matters. History of democracy matters. How long you have been practicing democracy matters. And this is an argument which reinforces one of the arguments that Olson had made in his 1993 famous paper, that yes, autocrats can do good for the economy, can promote growth, because it will also help him to plunder the resources. But in most cases, autocratic growth will be short-lived and uncertain, because autocratic regimes change in an uncertain manner, violent manner in most cases. So people who want to invest are unsure of what's going to happen when this particular autocrat goes away. But in a democracy, leaders may come and go, parties may come and go, but there is an institutional continuity, permanence, which gives a sense of a certainty, sense of permanence to the investors. So over the long term, investment, investors are most confident in investing in a democratic regime than they're investing in an autocratic regime. So longer experience in democracy is essential. So if you look at all these empirical and theoretical arguments, evidence together, theoretical arguments and empirical evidence, if you take them together, the conclusion that we reach, therefore, is today, in 2018, not in 2005, in 2017, the conclusion would be that the majority of the evidence almost conclusively demonstrates that democracy is superior to autocracy in its instrumental role alone in promoting growth, in promoting human development, in promoting stable environment, stable economic environment. Now, even if that was not the conclusion, even if we are simply saying that democracy is no worse than autocracy in terms of instrumental value, as I argued, we would still say that democracy wins, because with this constitutive value plus no less instrumental value, democracy would be still superior. But the fact that not only it has constitutive value, its instrumental value is also superior, makes the case even stronger. So there is no room for arguing that lack of democracy should be tolerated because it promotes growth better. There is no scope for making that argument. However, that does not end the controversy. There is major concern still remains. You may say that democracy is good for you, but people often come back and ask, well, it's good, but are we ready for it? In Bangladesh, in today's climate, I myself have been often asked this question, are we ready for democracy? If you are not ready for democracy, then what does it matter if democracy is good for not? Wait for the future. Now that's an interesting argument, and actually this argument takes two rather different forms. One is more narrowly economic, and the other more broadly sociocultural. The economic argument has been enshrined from a long time ago, actually starting from Aristotle to Hobbes, and then actually formalized by a famous political sociologist called Seymour Lipset in a paper published in 1959, which entitled Some Social Requisites for Democracy. In that paper, he demonstrated empirically, that democracy doesn't happen in poor countries normally. That democracy happens only at a higher level of economic development and the structural changes that go with it. That hypothesis has come to be known in the political science literature as the modernization theory. That democracy can happen in a sustainable manner only in a modernized economy, not in a underdeveloped economy. That's one sense people say that, are we ready for development? We are not modernized enough. Now, this argument that democracy can only be sustained at a high level of economic development actually was challenged by another political scientist, a very eminent political scientist, Adam Przeworski and his colleagues, in a book published in the year 2000 called Democracy and Development, the same title as today's topic. In this paper, he argued that yes, over time, you do see a correlation between level of economic development and a positive correlation between level of development and democracy. But that correlation does not imply that democracy can be attained only at high level of development. What this positive correlation is, he showed with empirical data, is the following. That democracy, actually he argued, can happen at any level of development. And often it happens randomly for particular unique circumstances. But then he argued that once democracy takes root, whether it can be sustained or not is a matter of economic development. That if economy is modernized, developed, democracy can be sustained better. If the economy is underdeveloped, there's often a possibility of slipping back, not sustained. It is the subsequent slipping back at low level of development, but sustainability at high level development that creates this positive observed correlation between the two. But that correlation doesn't mean that, that you cannot initiate development at early stage. You can. Himself, he in fact, Lipset himself agreed with that proposition with Professor Skin. Lipset himself, he argued in his original paper. I'm quoting two quotes from him. Political democracy exists and has existed in a variety of circumstances, even if it is most commonly sustained by a limited cluster of conditions. To understand more fully the various conditions under which it has existed may make possible the development of democracy anywhere. So he's not actually saying that democracies cannot be established in underdeveloped economies. Another quotation from him, small line, democracy is not achieved by acts of will alone, but men's wills through action can shape institutions and events in directions that reduce or increase the chance for the development and survival of democracy. That is nothing written on stone. It depends on us, our will, our actions. Through our wills and actions, it may be possible to initiate democracy and sustain democracy, even in a climate which is not modernized, which is still underdeveloped. There is no hard and fast. It depends on us. So don't let anyone tell you that we are not yet ready for democracy because we are underdeveloped and not very well modernized. But there's a second dimension of this issue of are we ready. The second dimension is sociocultural. The argument is that democracy requires certain norms of behavior, respect for each other, tolerance towards each other. You disagree, but disagree with respect and tolerance. That's the essence of democratic norms and democratic behavior. And people often argue that we don't do that. We still quarrel with each other. If we disagree with somebody, we immediately brand him as a traitor. And whoever, either you are chamcha of this country or chamcha of that country, no, if you are, your enemy is always unpatriotic, you are the only patriotic one. This kinds of attitude is antithetical to the sustainability of democracy. In that sense, he also argued that socioculturally, in some values of norms, we are not yet ready. Now come to think of it, and that's what they said, wait, we are not ready for democracy yet. Well, so come to think of it, it's a very funny kind of argument. Let's accept that our values and norms are not particularly good for democracy. But what good will it do if we simply wait? Will we just wake up one fine morning, few years from now, and also, oh, today we are all ready to embrace democracy because today our norms and values have changed. Whereas norms and values don't change sui generis. Norms and change have to be changed through culture, through practice, through trials and errors. So we have to go through this democratic process. However imperfect this process is, without going through this process, those norms and cultures, values will never change. So don't let anyone tell you that we are wait because we are not yet ready. We have to carry on with our pursuit of democracy. Whenever there is a restriction of freedom, we must fight against it. And we must fight against it for one other reason. It has been demonstrated that when in a so-called democracy, the freedoms are restricted, what we have has sometimes been described as illiberal democracy by the well-known journalist Fareed Zakaria. And empirical research, recent research has shown that illiberal democracies can often be worse than autocracies because illiberal democracies often combine the vices of both democracy and autocracy. You have the worst of both worlds. So don't accept the status quo of illiberal democracy. Let us all fight against it and try to restore democracy. It's not going to be easy. Nobody is going to grant us democratic freedom on a platter. We have to work for it, but we have to work for it. We have to fight for it. Don't let anybody tell you to wait for democracy to arrive. Thank you.